Okay, good morning everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for February the 11th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into the markets. Okay, what are we going to talk about today is the rebound in equities, especially after the US session with Nasdaq and S&P 500 hitting new record highs. Tonight we have Fed Chair Powell's testimony before Congress. Overnight, during the Asian morning, Wednesday, we have the RBNZ rate decision. The Reserve Bank of New Zealand decides on interest rate. Other events on today's agenda are the UK preliminary GDP for the fourth quarter, industrial and manufacturing production, and trade balance, all from the UK. From the US, we get the NFIB index, the JOLTS job openings as well, and the API report for last week, the American Petroleum Institute report for last week. Fed Chair Powell, as well as Governor Andrian Orr, the RBNZ Governor Andrian Orr, we have five more on our agenda. So let's start with the performance of the dollar against the other G10 currencies. The greenback traded higher against most of the other G10 currencies on Monday and during the Asian morning Tuesday. It gained the most against the euro, the kiwi, and the Swiss franc in that order, while it underperformed only versus Aussie, NOK, and the British pound. The performance in the FX world gives us a very blurry picture with regards to the broader market sentiment, and thus we will turn our gaze to the equity market in order to get more clues on that front. Here you can see that EU indices traded mix. Some of them were on the negative side, some of them were on the positive side, perhaps still digesting the fact that the coronavirus has killed more people than the SARS did back in 2002 and 2003. However, US equities traded in the green. You can see here the Dow, the S&P and Nasdaq all closed in positive territory, with the S&P 500 and Nasdaq hitting new record highs. The positive sentiment rolled over into the Asian session today as well, with China's Shanghai Composite and Hong Kong's Hang Seng gaining 0.39% and 1.26% respectively. Here we have to note that Japanese markets remained closed today in celebration of the National Day. Now, with the death toll due to the virus breaking the 1,000 mark, we find it very hard to explain the optimism from the US session onwards. Many suggest that investors rushed into US equity markets as recent economic data suggested that the US economy is doing very well, and thus it may be the safest place for investing in stocks, as it may feel the effects of the coronavirus the least. But if this is the case, why did China's Shanghai Composite close in positive territory? Is there still faith on China's measures to contain the virus or at least relieve the effects on the domestic economy? Questions for which I don't have an answer at the moment. In any case, we believe that investors are underestimating the potential impact of the fast-spreading virus to the Chinese economy and even to the global growth outlook. Even the World Health Organization warned yesterday that the spread among people who had not been in China may be the spark that becomes a bigger fire. So we stick to our guns that with no concrete signs that the virus could be stopped soon, the economic wounds could not only impact the first quarter, but also drag into the second quarter. Anything pointing to that direction may eventually prompt investors to abandon risk assets like equities and risk-linked currencies like the Aussie and the Kiwi in favor of the safe havens like the Swiss franc and the Japanese yen. Now, as for today, investors may take a break from the coronavirus saga and turn their attention to Fed Chair Powell's semi-annual testimony before Congress. He will testify before the House Financial Services Committee today, and tomorrow he will present the same testimony before the Senate Banking Committee. The message we got from the latest Fed meeting was that policymakers are not comfortable with inflation persistently under their 2% target, and with their favorite inflation metric, the core PCE year-over-year rate, staying below that objective since December 2018, expectations with regards to another rate cut are still on the table. According to the yields of the Fed Fund futures, such an action is more than priced in for the September meeting. You can see the graph here. This is the current rate of the Fed. 25 basis points is fully priced in for August, but given that we don't have an FOMC meeting scheduled for August, we see the case for September. Here you can see that a rate cut is more than fully priced in for September. Now, back to Powell's testimony. In our view, he could say that the economy is doing well, but we also expect him to reiterate that there is little tolerance to low inflation. We also expect him to acknowledge that the coronavirus constitutes a new risk to the economic outlook. The dollar could slide if Powell sounds somewhat more concerned than previously, as market participants may decide to bring closer the timing of when they expect the next cut to be delivered. For example, they could bring it from September to July. Nevertheless, as we already noted yesterday, bearing in mind that sometimes the US currency acts as a safe haven, we would treat any potential slide as a corrective move if concerns around the coronavirus intensify at some point soon. In such case, we prefer to exploit any potential upcoming dollar strength against risk-linked currencies like the Aussie and the Kiwi, which tend to slide during periods of market turbulence. Now, as for tonight, during the early Asian morning, we have a central bank deciding on interest rates, and this is the RBNZ. This will be one of the bigger meetings where, apart from the decision, the statement, and the minutes, we also get the quarterly monetary policy statement, which includes updated economic projections, as well as a press conference by Governor Andrian Orr. At its November meeting, the RBNZ surprised investors who were largely pricing in a rate cut and instead decided to stand pat, keeping its rates at 1%. That said, officials maintained an easing bias, saying that they will add further monetary policy stimulus if needed. They also noted that employment remained around its maximum sustainable level. So, since then, New Zealand's CPI accelerated to 1.9% year-over-year from 1.5%. You can see it on the graph here. Is just a tick below the midpoint of the bank's target range of 1 to 3%. You can also see that the 2-year inflation expectations curve is also pretty close to the midpoint of the bank's target range. Now, with regards to employment, the unemployment rate ticked down to 4% from a downwardly revised 4.1%. However, given that the employment change revealed no new added jobs, the decline in the unemployment rate may have been not for the good reasons. Indeed, with the participation rate sliding to 70.10% from 70.40%, the slide in the unemployment rate may be owed to many people being discouraged to register as unemployed and seek for a new job. In any case, our humble view is that the employment report was not that disappointing, and combined with the notable rise in the nation's inflation rate above the bank's latest projection for the quarter, which was at 1.6%, may allow policymakers to wait for a while more before they decide to cut. This may result in a higher QE, as some of those who were anticipating a rate cut in November may have pushed their bets into this meeting. Having said that, the big risk to our view is that the fast spreading coronavirus, which could have a negative impact on New Zealand's economy. Let's not forget that New Zealand is one of China's main trading partners, and the potential effects could eventually prompt a rate cut. Now, even if we are correct and the RBNZ does not cut interest rates tonight, any potential strength in the QE could stay short-lived in case fears with regards to the coronavirus returned into the markets in the coming days. QE is considered a commodity-linked currency and thereby a risky asset, and could come under selling interest if we see fears returning into the financial world. Now, in case the broader market sentiment switches back to risk off, we prefer to exploit any potential QE weakness in the aftermath of the RBNZ decision against the safe havens, the franc and the Japanese yen, which tend to attract decent flows during risk off periods. Now, as for the rest of today's events, during the European morning, we get a string of data releases from the UK. We get the preliminary GDP for the fourth quarter, expectations of which are for the quarter-over-quarter rate to have held steady at 0.4%, but this will drive the year-over-year rate down to 0.8% from 1.1%. What's more, following the first increase after five quarters of declines, business investment is expected to have tumbled again in quarter four. Specifically, expectations are for a 1.3% year-over-year slide, following a 0.5% growth in the third quarter. Both the industrial and manufacturing production year-over-year rates are expected to have risen in December, but to have remained within the negative territory, while the nation's trade deficit for the same month is forecast to have widened. When it last met, the Bank of England decided to hold rates unchanged, disappointing those who were expecting a rate cut to be delivered. That said, the statement had a more dovish flavour than the previous one, with the committee dropping its gradual tightening wording and adding that policy may need to reinforce the expected recovery in UK GDP growth. So, having all that in mind, softness in the aforementioned data may revive some bets with regards to a Bank of England rate cut and perhaps push the pound slightly lower. However, our own view is that policymakers will place more emphasis on data pointing to how the economy has been performing in the post-election era before they decide whether to cut or stay sidelined. After all, they clearly pointed out that they would wait for data to confirm the positive signals from the latest PMIs, with inflation taking the first place on the list. Now, from the US, ahead of Powell's testimony, we get the NFIB Small Business Optimism Index for January and the JOLTS Job Openings for December. The NFIB Index is forecast to have risen to 103.4 from 102.7, while the job openings are expected to have increased to 7 million from 6.8 million the month before. At this point, I have to note that neither of those two releases are usually major market movers. We also get the American Petroleum Institute weekly report on crude oil inventories, but as it is always the case, no forecast is available. Now, as for the speakers, apart from Fed Chair Powell and RBNZ Governor Orr, we have five more on the agenda. That's ECB President Christine Lagarde, Bank of England Monetary Policy Committee member Jonathan Haskell, which is one of the two members who are voting for a rate cut in the Bank of England. Then we have Fed Board Governor Randall Quarles, St. Louis Fed President James Bullard, and Minneapolis Fed President Neil Kashkari. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I hope you have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you seeing you here again tomorrow. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 8 o'clock a.m. GMT time. Goodbye for me, and have a great day.